Thank you, Dr. Singh. Friends, joining DRDO as a full-time member is not the only way of serving the nation with cutting-edge technologies. Accomplishing this monumental task of developing cutting-edge defense technologies, especially in the face of technology denials, blockades, and non-existent technology-based, industrial base in the country, would not have been possible without the active collaboration with the academia, with the industries, and other research institutions in the country across the length and breadth. We have active collaborations and participation with Indian industries numbering more than 1,000. Shri Sanjay Barman, who is an outstanding scientist and heading the Center for Artificial Intelligence and Robotics as its director, will be giving you a glimpse, a presentation on what are the various futuristic technologies, academia collaboration, and industry engagement. Let me introduce Mr. Barman. Shri Sanjay Barman took over the charge of director, Center for Artificial Intelligence and Robotics at Bangalore, with effect from 1st November 2012. He did his BSc Electronics and Communication Engineering from Sambalpur University, Odisha in 1985 and M.Tech in Signal Processing from IIT Kanpur in 1995. He is currently pursuing the PhD degree in the area of Reconfigurable Computing in IIT Madras. Shri Barman joined Electronics and Radar Development Establishment, LRDE, a premier DRDO laboratory in Bangalore in 1986. In November 2000, he shifted to the CARE, Bangalore. His current areas of interest are in the fields of communication, networking, security and allied subjects. He has contributed to the design of several security solutions which have been productionized and deployed in the field. He has won a number of Republic Day awards. He was awarded Sir C.V. Raman Young Scientist Award in 1999, Laboratory Scientist of the Year Award 2005, DRDO Army Award and Performance Excellence Award in 2005, 2006 and 2007 for development of secure communication systems that have been productionized. And he got the DRDO Scientist of the Year Award in 2010 from the hands of Honorable Prime Minister of India. Shri Barman is a founder member of the Cryptology Research Society of India. He is a member, he has a number of publications to his credit in the areas of cryptography, security, and reconfigurable computing in national and internet journals. So now, may I request Mr. Barman to give the presentation?
Off stage, and dear friends. I come in last. Most of my work has been done by the previous speakers. I'll try to rush through with a slightly different flavor and share with you and explore some of the points that my colleagues have already touched on. So the topic that was actually formally assigned to this session was futuristic technologies, academic collaborations and industry engagements. And I'll try to share each and every aspect of this with you quickly. So to begin with, I'll give a very short overview. This slide you have seen in a different form, that we have a very wide spectrum of technologies which you have seen, right from basic life sciences to advanced system of systems and multidisciplinary systems which need to be engineered. And we are organized therefore as seven distinct clusters. And I happen to belong to the computational systems cluster, which is right at the bottom right corner. So let's look at a little bit more in detail of the kind of projects we take. DRDO sells nothing. DRDO produces nothing. DRDO doesn't have a product of its own. But then we develop capabilities in niche areas which are critical to national security. So we develop technologies that have been denied, technologies that are very critical for self-reliance, technologies that are very sensitive and must be under government control and must be kept confidential. So we undertake the development of not only these technologies, but these technologies can't be done in isolation. They have to be translated into systems which go on to the field. So you actually need an ecosystem around it. So right from the concept development, the development of the science of it all, before the engineering can happen, we strongly engage with academia. And then, to translate the technology into systems, through a robust engineering, we engage with industry. And it is important to actually become completely self-sufficient in this aspect. Otherwise, you will have a technology which is not delivered. It doesn't make sense. You will have a science which remains a science in the lab, but it is not engineerable. So the effort and the challenge in front of DRDO is not just to develop technology, but then also how to develop the industry around you and engage very, very strongly with academia. We also jumpstart technology development through international collaborations, which you have heard about. So basically the effort there is to jumpstart it. So the impact of this you have already seen. What I would just like to share with you is, though we say we are 1 in 7 with its own 4th generation combat aircraft, out of the 7, 4 of those countries have completely failed in delivering that aircraft, a 4th generation aircraft. We are right there at the threshold of achieving it. So we will be in a very minor set of countries which had something like this of their own. So India's capability today can be summed up in 3 bullets, basically. We have a very effective deterrence against our adversaries. We do have a lot of technology leadership today. We are ahead of most of the countries. We compete with almost the best. And we are well positioned to also compete in the export of military systems, which we have not been doing because of our own self-imposed political reasons. Because everyone says we are a peace-loving country. But then you achieve peace in this day only using some sort of strength. And the strength is the deterrent. So the key enabler to this, which Dr. Singh pointed out to you, was that we are about 7,500 strong as scientists and engineers. Out of this, a very high percentage are PhDs, and every second one is actually a postgraduate. So how do we achieve this? This quality of manpower, not many institutions can actually boast of. So how do we get that? We get that through the R&D scheme, where we do sponsor the initial undergrad recruits who work with us for postgraduate programs in the best of institutes. We have targeted training programs which are very, very specialized, and they include a lot of engagement, not just within India, but also from abroad. We have 3 HR institutes and a deemed university within this organization, and that is all extremely helpful. Now, if you want to work in the area of system of systems and complex areas, and you need to do your knowledge management and your technology management, you must become process driven. So this is an organization which is strongly process driven. We believe in the processes, and we believe in compliance and conformance to these processes. Within this, when I was referring to developing an ecosystem, look, when you develop a system and it goes into the field, lives are at stake. At that point, you need assurance. Assurance about the system is reliable, the system is safe, the system is secure. And this can be achieved only through an independent assessment. So you also have to develop an ecosystem where you have these assurance agencies who maintain that independence and develop the capability to confirm the assurance in the technologies that are to be fielded with the services. So let's look at a peek into the future. Coming back to this slide, as I mentioned to you, I belong to the computational systems cluster, and CARE is one of the labs. So, what I'm going to say next, every lab has a story like that. But from my perspective, I'll share with you a peek into the future in the context of computational systems. So, CARE's technology domain can be decomposed into command control systems, cyber security, networking, intelligence systems, unmanned soldier assist systems. Now, this is a very, very diverse set of technologies, and it involves a lot of computational systems, it involves a lot of engineering, it is actually multidisciplinary, and most importantly, there is a key area which you need to be worked in. For academia, that is a very rich area to work in, and that is the science and engineering of dependability, which I'll touch on a bit more later. That is one thing which is not being discussed and covered within the academic literature. The science of the dependability is not yet mature. It is so immature that we don't even have the metrics and the methods to measure dependability. We don't even know the attributes of dependability. So the science is not settled. So I will touch on this a bit later. So some of you would have heard of a futurist called Ray Kurzweil. A quick profile of his is that he was the inventor of the flatbed scanner. And he is a multi-billionaire today. And he happens to be the vice president of engineering at Google. And he predicts the future. So he is known as a futurist. And he has some very interesting talks on YouTube. I would encourage some of you to go and have a look at it. So what the next few slides, I take from one of his talks, where he's talking about singularity and the future. So if you see, the cost of storage with respect to bits per dollar has really fallen from 1950 to 2010. From 1 bit per dollar to now it is about 100 billion bits per dollar. So storage has actually become very cheap. Let's look at bandwidth. Bandwidth also has become extremely cheap. Today many of you sitting in this hall must be texting at peanuts in terms of cost that you are actually paying. And cost of bandwidth, even in wired and wireless environment, both have actually been dropping very, very sharply. They are in fact dropping sharper than the Moore's law. So if you bring storage, Moore's law, bandwidth all together, you have an abundance. So we talk about scarcity of natural resources, but there is here, in this one area of science and engineering, an abundance. You have so much, you don't know what you can do, and you can do a lot. So let's see what happens. To my mind, we have a three-edged sword. We have abundance in computation, abundance in storage, and transmission. Now, what are we projected to achieve? Ray Kurzweil, we know, projects the future. One of the things that he says is by 2030, an artificial brain would have been created. That's one of his predictions. And by 2045, singularity will be achieved and man will become immortal. Why? Because each and every organ within our bodies would have been artificially regenerated and recreated. You have the artificial brain, you have the artificial organs. This is not a realm of science fiction today, because a number of your organs today have been regenerated and recreated in the labs. Actually, we in this community are actually expected to use these three abundance to create the future. And the onus is on us. The future looks extremely exciting. I wish I was born today, not 50 years ago. So let's look at this. Ray Kurzweil gives us six epochs. The first epoch, he said, was where you had only atoms, it was about physics and chemistry and DNA, what? That is where living beings came into being on this earth. At that time, the information started getting stored in DNS. Technology evolved into the brain. And the as the brain evolved, as the humans evolved, right from the caveman and the hunter-gatherers to the present-day society where we have reached, we have actually translated into Epoch 4, where a lot of information is in hardware and software designs. So we are actually living in this epoch right now. And Epoch 5 is where singularity will be achieved and you'll have a merger of technology and human intelligence. You'll have a merger of the artificial and the biological. These two will become indistinguishable. And if that happens, obviously all living beings can potentially become immortal. And the sixth epoch is where the whole universe wakes up. So where are we? We are at four, all of you will agree. But then, we have almost completed four and we are at the threshold of five and the epoch five has already begun. How many of you agree with this? Just raise your hand. I want to more see how many people are awake. So how many of you? Just about 20? Be fearless, please raise your hands. How many of you think? Okay. Oh, someone raised their hand last. That lady in yellow. Why do you think we have reached that? Anyway, you are then reaffirming the fact that you are going into epoch 5. Can you say why? Give an example. Why do you believe that? Please stand up.
DRDO taking any efforts to know about these different technologies which were there with us in the prehistoric time. For example, we see that right now there are several patent battles which are going on. For example, for Haldi and all that. Wherein we are engaged against America and all that, like patented it. But this technology was with us since a greater amount of time than they have developed. So similar way in case of defense is concerned, or more specifically, they say Indians were the first who came out with a design for an aircraft, but just because the Wright brothers were the first to give a demonstration, it was said that they were the first. So I just want to know if DRDO has brought about any efforts to identify such achievements that we as Indians had got in the past.
Now it's a very good question what you have raised. We have taken number of steps in the direction. The lesson learned from the past in the various kind of systems what we are developing. First thing is the spiral development. If we develop Mark 1, the number of the technologies what we have developed, the faster development of the technology. Already we have some module developed, so we can develop the next version, the updated version quickly because we have already developed some of the version. And so spiral development way, Mark 1, Mark 2, Mark 3, so the faster development, we can catch the speed and we can catch the world. So that is number one. The second point what you are saying, the IPR and that is the very good point what you have said, that we are going to strengthen now. Our IPR and the intellectual property right, the involvement of the industry as well as the academia, that filing of the patents and the IPR, that the protection of the rights, very important that we have to take care of, that we are going to strengthen in future much more, that we have a group, but that group we have to enlarge and we have to see that we should file the patent and the intellectual property right at the right time and we have to secure all those rights so that it should not go.
Thank you, sir.
There are three other labs who are working in the area of robotics, which we also refer to now in an expanded context as soldier assist systems. it includes cognitive sciences. So I'll just share with you, because time is short, I curtailed my talk a bit because I saw many of you were dozing off. So here it goes. So we work in the area of mobility, manipulation, autonomous navigation, and perception. So these are basic categories, and we have various kinds of locomotion. I'll show you a few interesting ones. Now, within the kind of categorization of autonomy, you have teleoperation, where you are fully controlled by the endpoint is fully controlled by a human operator. Then you have semi-autonomous, and then you have fully autonomous. In the context of a fully autonomous system, what happens is you simply have to articulate the mission to the machine. The machine will execute the mission autonomously. Whereas in semi-autonomous, it does not know the mission. Mission you know. It does local actions autonomously. So we will see some examples of this. And from here on, I'll give you some examples of what we are doing. Where, remember, I'm not talking about teleoperation at all. I'm talking about whatever I'm going to show you is in the realm of fully autonomous and semi-autonomous. Here, I have a video of a snake motion. Okay? Now, for example, at the head of this, it moves, it goes back, it goes forward, it moves, you will see a sidewinder motion, where a sidewinder moves on the sides along the in sand. So this particular motion, which it is actually depicting, is for different kind of terrains. Okay? This has an ability, it's not a toy, actually it can go inside pipes. Now, you can actually inspect pipes. At the head of this, you can put a sensor like a camera or a chemical sensor or a biological sensor, and it can go any which way. So it has actually raised its hood, where right now we have actually mounted a small camera there, and we can show you a picture of this getting transmitted. That's the easy part. But the movement that you saw right now, okay, notice a few things. A, that no one was controlling it. It was moving on its own. B, it was moving on very smooth surface. A rougher surface is easier to move in. You try to move on smooth things, you find it difficult, right? So getting this kind of a motion going on a very smooth surface is much harder than trying to do it on dirt or sand. Yes? You can imagine that, very easy, right? Let's look at this. Here, you have the notion of a bird. A bird walks, right? After that, the bird flies off. Yes? It is navigating on its own. And then the same bird has actually gone into the open sky. All this is happening autonomously. So there is indoor autonomous navigation, there is outdoor autonomous navigation. When it was launched, it is actually navigating, if you see. It is trying to avoid. It is not going and colliding with anybody. And obviously, its eye is actually a camera, and it is sending out some pictures. Quadcopter, many of you know about it. I'm not going to spend time on that. Here, this is an interesting one, where this is a very rugged and a robust device, and you will see this doing very interesting things. It can climb steps, it can come down steps, it can stop on steps, including its payload. Now if it comes on a step, a high step, using its articulated limbs, it can actually climb up those also, something which is very high and much higher than itself. It can topple and untopple itself. This is what you will see now. And then it has a capability of self-righting itself. Watch carefully. Okay? You'll see something more interesting. It's crossing a ditch now.
Now, can you take a guess of what is the weight that it can carry? It can walk on four. Suppose it comes across an obstacle or a small rock. It can raise itself up and go over that. Okay? It can be dropped because it will fall into ditches and it has to recover out of it. And it will still work. You will see something very interesting next. How much is the weight do you think it can carry, a human? Okay? Now this had to be done in the lab for two reasons. One, to convince ourselves that on smooth surfaces it will move easily without slipping. No track is going to slip. B, on a rough surface, a human will have a very hard time maintaining his balance. Okay? Then you have something interesting here. Here you have something which can climb a wall. So on the side which you see is actually a screen on which it is sending the video. So this can be used in counterinsurgency operations, where it can go and look into the window from exterior of a wall. Okay, and it sends the camera picture there. And here you have the two things married together, okay, where the big guy can carry the small guy, deliver the small guy to the mission. Okay, that also has the capability of self-righting itself. And then it will go and complete its mission. It can go up, it can come back down. So this is where I was referring to dependability. And this is a very rich slide for anyone in academia. On each and every bullet point, you have at least 10 PhDs. Not in total, a year. That is the amount of work that has to be done in this area. At least 10 PhDs per year on each and every line over here you have. So the amount of publication that can come out of this slide alone and the amount of academic work that has to be done in this slide alone, it is multidisciplinary and it requires a lot of effort to do. Now, I mentioned that autonomous system must be dependable, right? Now this was actually an armored personal carrier, where in you have a tank-like vehicle which is tracked, and soldiers sit in that so that they can be protected from small arms fire and maybe medium arms fire also. Now what we wanted to do was that we took this vehicle, we added into this a drive-by-wire technology, and then we added autonomy into this. So take my word for it, right now what you are going to see is something very interesting. There is no driver in this. There are people sitting on this and inside this, but there is no driver. Take my word for it. What you see in this right-hand corner here, this is the vehicle, this is the obstruction, which is this gentleman that you see. And there are some people at the back, which is being detected. So this is the view which the machine sees. This is what machine is seeing. Now watch carefully what happens. As the vehicle is moving, you see the red arrow also is moving along a track. And as the gentleman moves, the green arrow down below also moves. But you will find something interesting. The red arrow is trying to avoid him. Yes? Autonomously. So, this video is actually magical. The person who stood in front of it was a person who did the algorithmics with respect to autonomy. And he called me up one day 2 years ago and said, "Sir, in the trials it is working great.
I said, come back with a video that you stood in front of it. I was joking. He actually came back with this video. And it is magical. He had that much of confidence in this realization of his. And this is something which is very dangerous to do. If you guys think of doing something like this, please don't. It has to be done by professionals, as they tell you on TV, right? So, how do we deliver? So, how we deliver is, we have a user. We talk to the user and actually come up with a concept. Post that concept, we actually take up a science and technology development effort. And we have numbers like technology readiness level 1 to 10, and 1 is the least. So typically TRL level 1, 2, 3, you can look up on the web what TRL 1, 2, 3 means. And you actually take up something which we call science and technology work. And then, if the concept leads to a technology which is at a higher level of maturity, we take up what is known as technology development. That is when you have TRL level 4, 5, 6. So science and technology efforts lead to something greater than TRL level 3, leading to technology demonstrators. Now, from technology demonstration, you can actually go back to the user and say, this is what I can do for you. If the user is satisfied, it meets his operational requirement, he actually engages with the production agency. And the production agency comes back to us for transfer technology. We transfer this technology to the production agency. There's an engagement between the production agency and the user by which the acquisition actually happens of this capability. So this product. So up till now, on the left of the TOP line, the green line, you see is what DRDO's work was. So as I told you earlier, do we produce anything? Answer is no. We develop technologies. We develop capabilities. And these capabilities are delivered as products through an engineering ecosystem. I'll explore this a bit more in soon. So, sometimes the concept can lead to something which is at TRL level 5. At that point, we take up a mission mode project and straight away do a engineering for transferring the technology to the production agency, and we deliver to the user. So this is actually two places that we do transfer technology. Something which is a concept which we developed, matured, transferred. Something which was a concept which emerged, which we could readily do, technologies were matured and available with us, we could quickly deliver. Now, within this, what happens is, if the top left highlighted portion is where we leverage academia very strongly. And in the bottom right portion, lower portion that is, we leverage the Indian industry very heavily, heavily. So this is how we actually deliver technology. Academic engagements, academic collaboration. We have three models. One is for Blue Sky. Grant in it, Blue Sky is where we like what you are doing. You are very clear with respect to the problem. You have demonstrated an ability to work in that area. You are serious about it. We are satisfied, we fund you. We don't expect any great deliverable at that point, which DRDO will consume and use. But we want to encourage you to build a certain capability so that when we come to you with a request for a deliverable, you have the necessary ability at that point of time. You don't begin from a scratch. So if you look at it, about 250 academic institutes, 297 crores is the funding. The annual outgo is approximately about 60 crores per annum. Then we have the notion of directed research through research boards. And we have more than 90 ongoing projects in that. And we have research boards in various domains. First four are existing computational system and a number of other research boards. The microelectronics are at the proposal stage, which are likely to come into play shortly. And then we have deliverable research. You have been working in those areas. Blue Sky you have done. You have matured in that area. In a project which is at the technology demonstrator level or in the mission mode context, if we come to a situation where we need a quick work on something which will deliver to a project, we have something called CARS instrument. So as of now, about 116 projects worth about 16 crores are under execution as we speak. So CARS stands for Contract for Acquisition of Research Services. CARES Academic Collaboration, we have memorandum of collaborations with IITM, Jadavpur University, ISC, IIT Kharagpur. We have CARS which are going on with these IITs, NMITs, MS Ramaiah, SIT Tumkur. In foreign collaborations, we have some direct, targeted training program in the context of ICT security, which has been going on. Two batches have actually undergone this training successfully and returned. We are exploring possibilities of engaging with ETH Zurich, which is one of the top international schools. It is among the top three international schools worldwide in the area of security technologies for next generation internet. With Carnegie Mellon University, we have had a very long association, more than 12-15 years of engagement, working in various areas. As far as U-Student goes, we have an internship option where after 6th semester, we take undergraduates for a minimum of 16 weeks, where we will develop certain skills and some domain knowledge which you have not necessarily been exposed to during your academic curricula in the university. At the master's and PhD level, we take students at 6 to 12 month duration for their various internships and their projects. But then most importantly, the seats are limited. It's strictly on a first come first serve basis, and we get full very rapidly. In fact, for the next 2 years, I don't think CARE is in a position to take any fresh applications. So my suggestion and advice to the faculty here would be to please advise your students. If you are interested, look at our website. You like our work, what we do. Quite a lot of it is there on the website. If you need to engage with us, these are certain norms that need to be followed, and you have to apply early. Well in advance. We are going to have a nationwide robotic competition very shortly. This is being piloted by our lab in Pune, R&D engineers. It will have various difficulty levels. It is very low on funding barrier. You will not be required to spend much. Okay? And it has significant cash prizes and scholarships and fellowships where we will give you support for further higher education. Along similar lines, look out for a cybersecurity competition which we are trying to formulate and should be in execution early next year. Now, engagement with the industry. As I told you, we are a DRDO lab. We have academic collaborations, we have government-to-government collaborations, wherein inter and intra. By inter, I mean you have CSIR labs, you have ISRO, and you have atomic energy, and you may have agencies outside of the government, okay, like societies, CDAC, we engage with them. That is under the category of G2G collaboration. We collaborate together with them. At that phase, where we are designing and prototyping, we also collaborate with industry, where it is technology-centric. At that point, these industries are high on IPR, not necessarily capital-intensive. So we use them for prototype fabrication and capacity augmentation, and we work with them very closely. Then when we come to the design and engineering phase, our technology matures during that phase. And we engage with industry at that point for engineering-centric work. They translate the paper drawings into something that can be produced and taken to the shop floor for production and sustained across its life. And they also participate with us in the field trials of this. So this is the engineering and validation phase. And then you go to a production agency where the industry is capital-intensive. We do mass production there. They are involved in fielding. And they are involved in life cycle sustenance and maintenance. So these are the ways by which we engage with the industry in all three phases. In the first phase, we are the real executors, that is where the IPR is. In the second phase, we collaborate with the industry for translating the paper designs into something which is producible. And then, during the production phase, our involvement gets tapered down and the industry takes off. And we do our best through our processes to decouple from the industry during production phase, so that we can take on new development of newer technologies and industry progresses with the rest of it. So CARE has collaborated with these in the area of production as well as in the context of development. As Indian industry, we have worked with the public sector as well as the private sector. We do a lot of principled outsourcing. The outsourcing is for capacity, not capability. And if it is for capability, then we have a decoupling strategy in place so that we will not be dependent upon them. So this is an example of the kind of an ecosystem that got developed as a part of LCL. When I was telling you that in our various phases, we need an ecosystem, we need academia, we need industry. That LCA development has led to this kind of capability development to the nation. And I believe this is intrinsic to building the nation. So many of the things that we do get noticed, many of the things that we contribute to are actually not even noticed. It just happens. The nation develops. We are thrilled about it. Thank you very much.
Armed forces. But I heard that from your, that whatever selection is being done for the officer basis, it is based on the infrastructure which is provided by the DRDO. So we have a shortage of around 14,000 officers. Does that mean that the infrastructure is not available with the DRDO for those number of officers, or is that the people of India are not capable of handling your infrastructure?
Now, are you referring to the selection boards in the Army and Navy and Air Force?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, the Army, Navy and Air Force, our armed forces have very stringent standards for selecting the people. Now, it is the number of people who are coming forward. If more people come forward for serving the nation as a soldier, as an officer in the armed forces, I think this problem will be solved. Because DRDO has provided the technology to find out whether a person has a potential to become an armed forces officer or not. Based on it, his mental makeup, his physical and mental characteristics, so whether the person doesn't mean that the person is not suitable for that job. What is the requirement for a scientist and the requirement for some other job, a technician or some kind of a mentor, so many other jobs. But to be an armed forces officer, there are certain requirements. And DRDO's technology tells that whether the person is having the potential or not. It helps them identify the person. So what is needed is that we, the youngsters, come forward in a big way for serving the nation and take up armed forces as a career. Similarly, defense force, defense scientists as a career.
I wanted to know what are the careers for civil engineer in DRDO.
And our Chief Controller, Dr. Satish Kumar, my friend from DRDO, faculty and young students. Till now you had the opportunity of knowing more about DRDO and some aspects in detail and some aspects we touched that who we are, what we do, and to certain extent how we do and for whom we do. Now I am sure that you must have got excited and must be thinking that how you can be part of this team, how you can participate and become the part of DRDO. Whenever a young engineer or a postgraduate, he has to go for a job, let me see that what are his expectations, on what parameters he would opt or he would select his professional or job destination. I feel that there can be various parameters and requirements, but I'll say that basically there are three things for which he would be evaluating. Based on those parameters, he would be evaluating. First is earning, learning, and then the serving. I will not stop that just mere serving. I will go a step ahead, say that serving with a purpose, which I'll share with you. What do I mean by serving with a purpose? And ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you that DRDO offers all the three. Then I'll in my next about 10 slides share with you how you can become part of DRDO and what DRDO offers in earning, learning, and serving. To share with you, we have three types of manpower. One is the scientist, what we say, defense research and development services scientist. We classify them and we say that they are the brains of the organization. Basically, they are in the design and development activities. You please also go keep reading. At the other category is defense research technical cadre. What we say, the brown, they support, they help the scientist to accomplish their task and missions. And the third is the support, what we say, the admin and allied. I will just discuss or give more emphasis on the first category. And if we see how many we have already, Satish sir has told you, we have around 7,500 plus scientists in DRDO, and we have about 9,000 DRTC manpower, and about similar or bit different admin and allied. How do we induct the scientist in DRDO? There are various modalities. The first modality is the scientist eligibility or scientist entry test. Scientist eligibility test that is being conducted by Recruitment and Assessment Center, a dedicated center which we have in DRDO. For the last about few years, we are not able to induct scientists through SET because for the want of sufficient number of vacancies. But this system is in place. I hope that in near future, DRDO would again restart and this option would also be available to the young engineers. The other is campus placement or campus recruitment. This modality is on. Every year we recruit about little less than 100 scientists through this modality. The DRDO goes to the National Institute of Technologies, IITs, IISc for campus recruitment. Based on the basic criteria that the admission to these institutes should be through the national examination. It should be through national examination. Then the third is ROSA, what we say, registration of scholars with scholastic aptitude. This is on the fresh PhD researchers who have just completed the PhD. They can register themselves in RAC for this scheme, and their subject and their work is being evaluated by the concerned labs. If their work area is of interest to DRDO, then they are interviewed and directly inducted into DRDO, a step above what we say entry level is scientist B, but these students, those who have PhD, are inducted at the scientist C level. The other entry is through lateral entry. Lateral entry is the DRDO recruits or inducts scientists at any level, not at the entry level of B, C, D, E, at any level based on the requirement of the organization in niche areas. So anyone can enter, may not be suitable for the young lot, but the middle level scientist, this option is there. The other is NRI, the scientist, the talent which has gone abroad, they are working there and they want to come back. There is an option in DRDO, they can be inducted into DRDO through video conferencing. They apply to NDRDO, the biodata is screened. If the work area is suitable or required in DRDO, he is interviewed and inducted at the appropriate level depending upon his experience and expertise. The last modality is internal modality, where the internal, the DRTC people can also become scientist through internal competitive exam. I think we can leave that, but this I can just touch upon the DRTC. Here we induct two type of technical people. One is at the diploma level, what we say 3 years diploma in various specialties. They join DRDO as Group B non-gusted officer, and then they can have a good career progression. They go up to the, let's say, 7600 grade pay, which is equivalent to scientist D in DRDO. Now if I see the career progression, now after induction, how do we grow, how do they grow in DRDO? In DRDO, the career progression is in scientist is for as per flexible complementing system. It's a very good system. Why I want to just say a few words about it, that you get promoted to the next higher grade if you are found fit. Your vacancy, your post is upgraded. It means your promotion is not denied for any level for the want of vacancy. And you can reach, if you enter at scientist B level, which is the entry level, maybe at average, these are the just indicative ages and residency, and you can reach up to the scientist G level, which in government of India we can say scientist H is equivalent to the additional secretary level, or we call it as HAG grade, by 47, 48 years. And after that, still there are two opportunities. There is personal upgradation to distinguished scientist, where we have one distinguished scientist right here, Dr. Satish Kumar, and for that matter, the promotion in DRDO can be up to President of India, because Dr. Kalam had reached to the President of India, or recently our former scientific advisor has been made the member, permanent member of Niti Aayog. This is on the lighter side, but DRDO offers a good career progression. I think about 70% of the scientists who are entering at scientist B level, and if they keep working satisfactorily above average, are likely to reach to the scientist H level. Perks and incentives. In case of earning, what DRDO offers? DRDO, when you become a scientist, you are designated as scientist B, that is the entry level, and you are a central government employee. Why I am mentioning this? That all the perks linked to the central government employees, you are entitled for that. You are entitled for that. I need not to go into the detail, but what special incentives DRDO offers is, number two, professional update allowance. You get about 20,000 rupees per year for your professional updation, for the purchase of journals, for attending conferences, or participating in any technical or academic activity. You also get the variable increments that is linked to your performance in the assessment for promotion, and this can be up to 10,000 rupees if you are able to perform at the highest level and you are able to maintain that performance at that level. I think you can go through that. We also offer one-time incentive for acquiring higher education, children education allowance, and one another facility which DRDO scientists get is CSD facility, and for health, CGHS facility is extended to DRDO being a central government department. When it comes to the learning, because there was a time when all the engineers, they would go to different jobs or concerns, mainly deciding on the earning. And that was the time when a person will hop, job hopping. After 1 year, if he gets the hike of about some 1,000 rupees, he will immediately change the job. But slowly the concept is coming and people are getting more mature that not only earning should decide the place of working. And this is where we drive a bit more strength that DRDO offers the learning opportunity. Whenever you are in DRDO, you are learning. Why I want to say that? I don't want to demean the multinationals. You will find that an engineer is recruited and then he is in the sales. Engineer is recruited and he is in Procter and Gamble and selling the toiletry. On one side, he is a communication engineer. If you discuss with them, I don't know how far they are utilizing their knowledge or technical knowledge in their day-to-day life. But DRDO offers learning. How do we do that? We have got a very, very competitive environment. When you enter into the lab, you are among the young engineers, educated people. You are not coming in contact or you are not discussing with anyone less than, let's say, graduate or postgraduate. And you are always discussing, learning from them, exploring to solve the problem. We also sponsor the scientists to acquire higher qualification. And DRDO has got a scheme where every year about 150 scientists are sent for postgraduate ME and MTech in the national institutes in this country. We also send our scientists for trainings and we send them for high-end specialized trainings, what we call the targeted trainings. And those trainings could be in India or could be abroad, could be short term or could be long term. DRDO supports scientist participation, their participation in conferences at national level and at international level. And when you are sponsored for international level conferences, it is not a partial sponsorship. Then what you say, it is end-to-end sponsorship, right from home to back home. While DRDO does the collaboration or interacts with academia and industry, you get the opportunity to learn. You discuss, you rub your shoulders with the stalwarts in their respective fields. And I think I won't be wrong in saying that DRDO has one of the best or state-of-the-art infrastructure. You get the opportunity to see those infrastructure, work with those machines and equipments and learn. For your performance, the encouragement does not stop here. Those who are high performers and they contribute, they are also awarded through various award schemes in DRDO, like Technology Award, Young Scientist Award, and these awards are given away every year by either Prime Minister of India or the Defense Minister of India. And there are certain awards which are at lab level, are given to high performers and those who have contributed at higher level than others. When I come to serving, you know, if you ask any young engineer that why you want to join this service, generally he will say, I want to serve my country. Fair enough, he wants to serve his country, but the baseline is he also wants to earn his bread and butter while serving the country. Because he will serve his country when he earns his bread and butter. DRDO provides you serving while earning and learning and serving with purpose. I want to share with you a small story why I want to say serving, and this came, I have picked up from the Harvard Business Review. The IBM personal computer section was taken over by one Chinese company. And then the Chinese company gave an advertisement that we want to hire the young engineers to work in the recently acquired personal computer section of IBM. The engineers who came to seek the job, they said, we would like to work with you since you are just starting at a lower salary. Then the management was surprised and they asked, why you want to work for us for a lower salary?
they said that we are so proud that a Chinese company has acquired the personal computer section of IBM, and this is with a purpose that we are proud of the China, their country, and there is a purpose in serving, so we will serve this company at a lower salary. And that kind of opportunity, that kind of, you know, opportunity or option DRDO provides, because you are directly serving the nation, the security cause of the nation. So I would like to conclude in saying that DRDO offers you a bright career while you earn, learn, serve, and you serve with a purpose. You can join. I give you a clarion call. Already my two colleagues have invited you to join DRDO, and whosoever wishes to know more, wants to join DRDO, can visit our site www.drdo.org. Thank you.
Our R&D engineers in Pune, they have their number of the civil engineering for making the bridges for the R&D. We have the number of the bridge systems they have developed. So it's a combination of the mechanical and the civil engineering. So that is one. This one we have SASE in Chandigarh. Sonoya branch studies the combination of the physicist and the civil engineers. So, and nowadays one thing I would like to tell you, that there is no barriers of the engineering today's world. You have the any branch of engineering, you can go and work in any branch of engineering. That mindset you should not have. But specifically, the civil engineering, we have a civil engineering group also in DRDO, which basically
DRDO website. Yeah, please.
Good evening, sir. I'm Neha Sangorkar from Goa College of Engineering. As you all had mentioned before, for campus placements, you all go for NIT, IITs. So, being a student from government college, how can we apply for it? Meaning, any opportunities like for the with regards to on-campus placements? Because you can't deny the fact that there are many intellectual students in many other colleges as well who didn't get opportunities before for, like, for some of the other cases, get into IITs and NITs.
You are very right that equal opportunity should be provided to all, and we are very conscious about that. DRDO is very conscious about that. I told you that all the various modalities, and campus placement is one of the modalities. Campus placement is one of the modalities, and we recruit through that. But for time being, for some years, for the want of vacancies, because if you run an All India test, there has to be some minimum essential numbers, because running an All India test, it's a huge mammoth exercise. So certainly when we get the vacancies, sufficient number of vacancies available to DRDO, DRDO will certainly go for set All India examination.
What Parman gave a lecture, see, there are number of areas in the cyber security, the low intensity conflict. There are many areas in the communications, the security area. So that's we are stressing now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So I wanted to know whether DRDO it organizes conferences so that members from the academia.
In fact, they are
members
having
from
a
the
conference.
Academia.
Yeah,
yeah.
Participate
yeah.
In that.
See, as I mentioned to you, if you recall my slide on DRL levels 1, 2, 3. Okay. So when you are not there. Even at 1, you are below 0. Okay? So at that point, in concept exploration, concept development, we do have various kinds of conferences that we do support. Actually, in my slides, I'm sorry, I did not cover that. It's actually a very good point you brought up. I didn't cover the conferences that we support. This year alone, DRDO has supported more than 250, 300 conferences, to the best of my knowledge. And these conferences are of various categories. They are at the basic science, they are at the technology level, and they are also at the engineering level, and they are multidisciplinary also. So we do support. In fact, when I spoke about blue sky research, which is a grant in it, that is precisely for addressing this kind of work. As a part of that project, DRDO will fund you for doing that work. There are only two essential requirements, basic requirements. A, you must be clear about what you are trying to do. Okay, you must have identified a problem which is well posed, and you must demonstrate a certain ability to undertake that task. Okay, so if that happens, we do fund that. As a part of that, you are encouraged to spend the funding that you get in building up basic infrastructure, in participating in conferences, in inviting domain experts for delivering those lectures. You can organize workshops and use the funding which is available to you. DRDO also will participate in those with you very closely. Thank you, sir.
Did I get the point? Working environment in DRDO, if you are asking that question, it is very good for, it does not distinguish, quite frankly, it does not distinguish between men and women. There is no such barrier. It's up to you to prove your best. In terms of percentage of women professionals who are there,
extramural research, if you send the proposal to him, that will be vetted. And that will be vetted in the technical context. You are just like a peer review paper, you will get responses. And based upon that, you can refine. If we like the proposal, funding will come. Okay? But it should come through formal channels of your college. Right now, we do not have an instrument which will allow individuals to suddenly propose something. Okay, it should be institutionalized. It should be through your institute. Since you are a student, there is absolutely no problem. You can simply propose that through your faculty advisor, and it would come to us formally, and we'll deal with it. Many details of this is available on our website. If you go to our DRDO website, you can go to various menus and drill down. The processes, procedures are actually there.
Everything that begins must have an end, and what ends will have a new beginning. I call it a new beginning. I'm sure many of you will be enthused and like to explore more what the idea is and how to work together. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna tells, Panjatani Mahabaho Karanani Nibodhme Sankhya Kritante Bhoktani Siddhaya Sarkarma Adhishthanam Tathakarta Karnam Cha Prathak Vidam Vividhashti Prathak Cheshta Devam Cha Vadu Panchamam. Here in DRDO, DRDO offers opportunities for all the four. And when we have all these four and the intentions are right, the fifth one automatically flows in. So before I end, I will be failing my duty if I don't. I will be thanking, first of all the people who are in the audience, the students, the teachers, the academia, the media people, they are still there, for giving a patient hearing and being with us. My sincere thanks and gratitude to Professor Jayant Sahasrabudhi for inviting DRDO's participation for this session and giving opportunity to interact with all of you. I am extremely grateful to Dr. Kamath and his team for organizing everything so meticulously and putting everything in place and making us at home, feel at home. I also thank my team of my colleagues from DRDO and the people who are sitting here and on the dais for taking beats and organizing for this participation. So I now hand over to Mr. Chetan. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. I guess we have spent a lot of time over here asking a lot of questions. I'm sure that all of you have benefited greatly. It's a real pleasure for us to have the team from DRDO to answer all these questions, to give some wonderful, you know, sessions to us. So thank you once again, sir.
पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उच्छल वंदा हिन्दहिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधित नंदा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाए तव जय गाता जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
थैंक यू
नेम इज निखिल देवकर एंड आई एम अ स्टूडेंट इन गोवा कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग आई वुड लाइक टू नो मोर अबाउट what efforts VRDO is making in participation of academia in the more less mature technology like conferences and all, whether VRDO has any work in this area as well.
Participation in the VRDO, how comforting and how difficult it is to be a part of it and yes, I guess you got my question.
Yes, I do. As a professor with the Goa College of Pharmacy Panji. Sir, my question is regarding with the career opportunities for the pharma professionals. Being a pharma cognosy person, means we are dealing with the herbal formulations development and their evaluation. Means I have seen that there are certain formulations for wound healing. We are dealing with the same thing, sir. In fact, we are working on the radioprotective formulations also. That is the radioprotective herbal formulations. Is it possible to do a collaborative research work with the DRDO? Because being a government organization, because of my college, it comes under the government of Goa. So is it possible to do some collaborative research work or what kind of opportunities for pharma professionals will be in a DRDO?
You are raising two issues. Yeah. One is how you can, a pharma professional can join DRDO. The other is how you can collaborate in the research area of herbal radio protectors.
Yes.
The first is depending upon your qualification, you can enter DRDO with pharma qualification at two levels. One with the diploma at STAB level in DRTC, and if you are BPhar or MPhar, then you can also join through lateral entry into DRDO. I can share with you, we have at least I know half a dozen people who have a pharma qualification and are very active scientists in our life sciences cluster, which Dr. Rajesh Arora mentioned. As far as your collaboration, I think that is the area where Life Sciences Cluster Lab Institute of Nuclear Medicine and Allied Sciences is actively working. You can write to the director in mass or DG Life Sciences. And certainly, if collaboration, if both parties have something to gain, you can.